Hello, anatomy colleagues. This is Dr. Alsup, and in this mini-lecture, we will be discussing how bone tissue is actually organized, forming two major organizational types. And these two major types are referred to as compact and spongy bone, and while they are made up of the same general components, they are organized differently and have some very characteristic differences that can be seen both microscopically as well as grossly or with the unaided eye. We will also describe the basic composition of a long bone, specifically the compact portion of the long bone. In other words, what is the microscopic organization that helps form the robust, hard bone that we normally think of? So again, the two major organizations of bone tissue form compact and spongy bone. And you can see in this image here that the compact bone, which I am outlining kind of all around this region here, is very dense looking. You see no holes or spaces other than this very large space in the middle of the long bone, which is actually the medullary cavity. We'll talk about that in a bit more detail in another video. This is where the yellow bone marrow sits during life. So that's going to be the compact bone. You can see it here and here. Whereas with the spongy bone, you can see these little beams of bone kind of all over the place. All this area right in here is going to be made up of spongy bone. And there's considerably more space between these little beams of bone. One other thing you can notice is that the compact bone is most present in the middle portion of the long bone, or the shaft, or the body, whereas the spongy bone is much more prevalent on the ends of long bone. So we're looking at the proximal portion of the femur here. So that's going to be the end of the femur. But you can also have spongy bone in many of the short or flat or irregular types of bone in higher frequencies. But it's important to note, and you can't really see it very well here, but it's important to note that there's always a layer of compact bone. You can see a little bit of it here. There's always a layer of compact bone around the edges, even around the spongy bone. So spongy bone is always protected by a covering of compact bone. Compact bone, as you may have guessed, is important functionally in support and protection, but it also really is important in terms of resisting stresses produced by movement and weight. So really important in terms of that strength and bending. Spongy bone is located, as we mentioned, most frequently at the ends of long bones, which are very vital in joint formation. So it really makes sense that trabeculae, while appearing not to be as organized, are actually very well organized to help reduce stress and overcompression of the bone. Before we move into breaking down these types of bones into their microscopic parts, I do want to take a quick terminology break and let you know that you may hear these types of bones being referred to by different names, maybe even by me in this very same video. Now, you may hear compact bone referred to as cortical, which means referring to an outer layer of tissue, or dense bone, both pretty descriptive names. Whereas spongy bone is sometimes referred to as trabecular. In fact, I often use that term. That's what I learned when I was in school. Trabecular, it's called trabecular because those beams of bone that we saw visible to the unaided eye are called trabeculae. You may also hear the term cancellous bone. Cancelli in Latin means crossbars, so those trabeculae look like crossbars. Okay, so I've bought myself some cover here in case I use these terms, and you may hear it if you're in another course or in some other textbook, so I did want to present these. But for your purposes on any assessment, I will use the terms compact and spongy bone. All right, so let's talk about the microscopic organization of compact bone that makes it look like what we saw in the last image. So that's looking like there's not a tremendous amount of space. So at that gross level, compact bone looks dense, completely solid. But when viewed under a microscope, you actually begin to see this beautiful and richly complex organization of both bony tissue, but also importantly, there's a lot of spaces and canals. A major difference between compact and spongy bone is that only compact bone is organized into these repeating structural units called osteons, or more traditionally referred to as haversian systems. Osteons are aligned in similar directions and are parallel to the diaphyseal length, which we like to refer to as lines of stress or stress lines, which is important in resisting bending forces. These lines of stress are dynamic and can and will change throughout life, sometimes considerably, as in when we're talking about juveniles learning how to walk, so that can tremendously change the lines of stress, or even to a lesser extent with, say, with targeted weight training, you can have changes. So it's really key to understand that how these osteons are organized are going to be dynamic through life. Each individual osteon consists of concentric lamellae, and I am underlining concentric here. I'm going to even make it a nice box because I want you to understand we're talking about concentric here, because there are different type of lamellae. So you have concentric lamellae surrounding and organized around a central canal. So here is a central canal here in the middle, and then the concentric lamellae will be organized around the central canal. All right, so you can see that here as well. So here in the middle is the central canal, and then concentric lamellae surrounding it. The central canal is the space, so that's key. The canal is a space that the neurovasculature serves the osteon run. And returning to the term lamellae, lamellae means plate-like, okay? So that's what this term is. We'll see it in a moment as well. So what you have are these concentric or circular plate-like components of mineralized or calcified bony extracellular matrix. And these will increase in diameter the further you get away from the central canal. And it's really these concentric lamellae that give bony tissue that very distinct ring-like appearance. You see when you see these microscopic sections of a bone, that's what we're looking at here, is a microscopic section of the bone. You can see a central canal, say here, and then the concentric lamellae are just following around, getting progressively larger the further you get away from the central canal. But what are the rest of these little dots throughout? What are those? Well, these are mostly spaces referred to as lacunae. All right, so lacunae or lacuna if we're talking in the singular. And these are going to be located between the concentric lamellae. So that is what you're seeing interspersed throughout these rings here. So all these little dots right here. And sitting within, these lacunae are our old friends, those mature bone cells, the osteocytes, which I hope you recall are vital to bone maintenance and metabolism. So, the osteocyte cell body is sitting within the lacunae, and their cellular extensions or processes sit in extensions of the lacunae. So it sit in extensions of those spaces, and these are referred to as canaliculi. So here is the cell body sitting in the lacunae, and then the processes are sitting in the canaliculi. Canaliculi of other lacunae will meet with other canaliculi and spread out actually quite prolifically to allow communication and exchange between osteocytes throughout. And this system provides many avenues for nutrients and oxygen to reach the osteocytes, as well as a means of waste removal. So when we're talking about the osteocyte being a living cell and playing a role in terms of maintenance, this is how that communication is allowed, because these processes can sit within those canaliculi. So just to review, both lacunae and their extensions canaliculi are spaces, all right? I have that underlined, but that is a concept that I have found most students have some difficulty with. So these are spaces where the osteocytes and their cellular processes sit between concentric lamellae, and those concentric lamellae, remember, surround the central canal. So these structures and spaces are what make up the osteon. Now, in areas between neighboring osteons, there are often fragments of older osteons that are partially destroyed either due to bone growth or bone remodeling, and these are called interstitial lamellae. And you can see them just kind of in between the osteons. These will have structure, these may still have some structures of an osteon. So there may be lacunae, as you can kind of see in these regions here. You don't have the organization of an osteon, but you can still see components of broken down osteons there. And that makes sense if we return back to this. It makes sense that you're going to have some broken down osteons because remember, bone is dynamic. It's changing throughout life. So you may have the breakdown of certain osteons and the building of new osteons throughout life, not just when bone length ends. Now, neurovasculature needs to make its way from the outside of the bone, which you can see in this image here, it needs to make its way from outside to the inner portions to eventually run through central canals, as you can see here, of osteons, or even to the larger medullary cavity, as you can see here. And it does so through transverse or perforating canals, often referred to as Volkmann's canals. Lastly, let's discuss one more type of lamellae. So I told you that term would come up again. So we're not talking the concentric lamellae. This time we're talking circumferential lamellae. All right, so circumferential lamellae surround the entire outer, all right, which you can see really nicely right here. Oops. Yeah, it's going all the way around the entirety of the bone. And then you'll also have inner concentric lamellae that are going to kind of surround that endosteal region. The outer circumferential lamellae is just deep to the periosteum, or that connective tissue lining around the bone, and actually connected to the periosteum by perforating, excuse me, my voice is trying to give out on me. It's surrounded by those perforating or Sharpie's fibers are going to kind of be interspersed throughout there. And these Sharpie fibers are very important as well because muscle tendons will often intertwine in certain areas of bone and periosteum to form that extremely close connection between these structures, which is you certainly need for muscle contractions to really lead to bone movement. It is these circumferential lamellae that play a huge role in appositional growth. And we'll have a whole video talking about interstitial and appositional growth. Appositional growth is growth of the outer surface, so particularly important in increases in bone width. So that was compact bone in a nutshell. And as a reminder, spongy bone has the same structures that we just described. But the key here is that they are not arranged in osteons. All right, they're not arranged into those structural units of an osteon. They still have the same components, just not organized in that way. And they will have these very distinct trabeculae, which means little beams of bone or columns of bone that are separated by much larger spaces. And these macroscopic spaces are filled with red bone marrow in some bones and yellow bone marrow in others. Now, I know it looks like the bones are kind of formed in a willy-nilly, all-over-the-place way, but they are exactly organized along lines of stress. So they're often in places where stress comes from multiple directions, and that's why those trabeculae look like they're irregular or disorganized, but they're very much formed wherever there's stress coming, most typically with that bone. Also, these spaces help to reduce the weight of the bone, so that helps in terms of just the weight of the skeletal system. All right, so those are the basics of compact and spongy bone. Let's take a minute to review a concept. All right, so question. Osteocyte processes sit within which area of an osteon? Is it A, canaliculi, B, central canal, C, interstitial lamellae, D, lacunae, or E, perforating or Volkmann's canals? All right, so take a minute and pause it. And when you're ready to go, I want you to note that the key to these questions are osteocyte and processes sit. So they're sitting within. And while osteocytes do sit in lacunae, so those osteocyte cell bodies sit in the lacunae, this is not correct because of this term here, the processes. Those processes sit in the spaces called canaliculi. So A, canaliculi is the correct answer. Recall canaliculi are extensions of the lacunae that allow for the osteocyte processes to sit and communicate with other osteocyte processes. The central canal is not correct. This is where neurovasculature resides, within the central portion of an osteon. Interstitial lamellae is also incorrect. These are remnants of older osteons located between those functioning osteons. And perforating Volkmann canals are not correct either. Those are those transverse tunnels by which neurovasculature enters the deeper portions of bone. All right, so if you missed this, that's no big deal. You just now know that this is an area you need to review again. And just to let you know, this particular video and the concepts within are a little conceptually difficult, so you may need to kind of sit down and write down your own definitions for each one of these terms. So take it as a learning opportunity. Thank you for kind of working through this material with me. And you can always please feel free to reach out with any questions, and have a great rest of your day.